Is there a Ukraine effect? After months of protesters clashing on the streets of Kiev, Bosnia and Herzegovina is seeing some of its worst violence and unrest since the war two decades ago. Across the country, including its capital, Sarajevo, demonstrators have taken to the streets, setting fire to government buildings, trashing libraries, torching vehicles. Because of high unemployment, unpaid wages, and government corruption and incompetence, the protests have now turned more peaceful, but European leaders seem to have heard their message loud and clear. The British Foreign Secretary William Hague tweeted, "It's a wake-up call to us all, and we need a new European effort to help Bosnia towards the EU and NATO." So far, the EU has failed to smooth that way. And with unemployment conservatively estimated at 40% in Bosnia, the people there have yet to reap a peace dividend since the 1995 Dayton Accords that ended the war. They split Bosnia in two and created a cumbersome and dysfunctional political system of multi-layered and competing governments and bureaucracies. Few people know better what ails Bosnia and how to fix it than Lord Paddy Ashdown, who's the former High Representative and Europe's special envoy to Bosnia after the war. As the war had raged across the heart of Europe in the 1990s, Ashdown led the call for decisive action to end it. And he tells me that Europe needs to move swiftly and decisively right now to put Bosnia back on track before this latest unrest unravels into an uncontrollable storm. Paddy Ashdown, welcome to the program. I first went to Bosnia on one of the most terrible trips, looking at the prison camps with you 20 years ago. So much has happened since then. The worst unrest since the war. What is this saying to you, and are you surprised?
Christiane, the story of Bosnia and Herzegovina, as you know, since the days you were there, is one of two halves. The first 10 years after the war, Bosnia and Herzegovina made greater, faster progress than any other country post-conflict in the world.
That's a remarkable statistic, and not many people understand
that. I mean, 1 million people went back home, 1 million for the first time ever. Refugees returned to their home. We created a single army, a single intelligence service, a single taxation, and it was going extremely well. And then the European Union, I have to blame the European Union, I'm afraid, decided that the days of total ownership were over. They would withdraw the leverage that they had to push things forward. The truth is that since 2006, all of those huge advantages made, not, let me say, Christiane, by the international community, but by very brave Bosnian politicians, have been allowed to unravel.
Well, now, what it seems is people who weren't even born during the war years, young people, yeah, are really upset. They have no economy, they have no jobs. Yeah. It is a terrible situation. They're very frustrated by their present-day politicians, who they accuse of corruption and total ineffectiveness.
There's the good news and the bad news. Maybe, and at last, the citizens of Bosnia and Herzegovina are turning against a political clique who have governed the country, been allowed to govern the country, I must say, made it dysfunctional, deep in corruption. And if this is the worm turning and people and citizens are now demanding better, that's a good thing. Now, the bad news. You know better than me that the situation in Bosnia and Herzegovina is highly fragile, that it could shift into something ethnic. This is a very dangerous moment, potentially, not from what's happened, but from what could happen. Two facts are about to happen. The first is a census. That's never been done before. That will show Bosnia divided, I fear, ethnically, and may encourage secessionism. And the second is the elections later in the year. So the potential from a situation which at the moment is citizens complaining about poverty and lack of movement and dysfunctionality of the state and corruption amongst politicians could move to something far worse.
Well, fighting, you're talking about.
Look, my
own major unrest.
No, I don't believe that a return to conflict is likely in Bosnia and Herzegovina, but because of the dysfunctionality of the state, and I blame the European Union in large measure for allowing that to happen, I mean, they have more instruments to continue Bosnia's journey towards a functional state capable of joining the European Union, and they've failed to use them. So Bosnia has sunk back into dysfunctionality.
In the meantime, the Foreign Minister of Great Britain, William Hague, has said this week, in the face of these protests, this is a wake-up call. We've got to try and put Bosnia's accession to the EU and NATO on a fast track. Is that even likely?
We have to make Bosnia a functional state. The Foreign Secretary and I wrote a warning that this would happen 4 years ago before the election. He has done his best to make this happen. I have to say the rest of the European countries have not backed that. But
what are they doing wrong?
Well, they're allowing everything to unravel. It has opened the door to a mood of secessionism, especially in Republika Srpska, run by a highly opportunist Prime Minister Milorad Dodik. That is beginning to unstitch the cohesion of Bosnia. The international community has to act now. If they don't act now, I greatly fear that a situation where secessionism will take hold could easily become unstoppable as we approach the elections. And then, if you're going to move to the breakup of Bosnia and Herzegovina, I don't say conflict is a most likely outcome, but I can't discount it.
Does Dayton need to be revisited?
Undoubtedly, Dayton, which was the ideal solution to the war, is the wrong basis to build a sustainable state. And it's exactly that that the European Union must now push for. They go beyond Dayton to build a functional state which can serve its citizens. And at present, that isn't the case.
And I cannot let you go without asking you about our own country, right here, Great Britain. Your area where you live, the area you represented, is underwater. You're going back there now.
Exactly.
You're the leader of the Liberal Democrats. Your party is in governing coalition right now, and the government is under serious criticism for its handling of this crisis.
This is an act of God. It's an act of God that has gone beyond the scale anybody could have imagined.
What should happen? I mean, it's the worst it's ever been.
Yes, so politicians take on God. Usually God wins, Christiane. That's the truth of it. Now,
Could they have deployed more rapidly? Could they have taken it slightly more seriously?
We should look at that, I think, in the aftermath of this. I don't think it's worth wasting one moment to decide now where the blame lies. Clearly, it hasn't been done as well as it could have been. We need to concentrate on one thing. It's what the government is doing. By the way, I think the opposition is doing it as well. It's getting together and acting to be able to help these people in the terrible position they find themselves in. Much more important, we concentrate on the action today and look at who's at fault when this thing's passed.
And what about preventative next time? Does the government have to worry about climate change and real policies to prevent this kind of thing?
I certainly hope that it means the end of the climate change deniers, which are a very powerful force still in the Tory party. I hope we won't hear any more of that. And the answer is yes, and it opens some very big questions. Do you sacrifice farmland to protect towns? I mean, these are fundamental questions. So, three things. First of all, we're dealing with an act of God of proportions no one could have imagined. Secondly, the immediate thing is to give some relief to those who are suffering so terribly under these circumstances. Thirdly, we need to decide how we got here later on. And alongside that, we need to think about what the long-term policies are facing what is, as you rightly say, a global consequence of global warming.
Lord Paddy Ashdown, thank you very much for joining me.
Nice to be with you.